Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Vikas Jain from BS Anangpuriya Institute of Pharmacy, Faridabad. Today I am going to talk about the module Suspension Part 1, Theoretical and Formulation Consideration from paper Product Development 1. The learning objective of current module includes a basic understanding of pharmaceutical suspension and its importance, types of suspensions, suspension formulation including importance of particle size and charge, formulation consideration including role of wetting, flocculating and deflocculating agents. Biphasic liquid dosage forms essentially consist of two phases, and based on these phases they are classified as either suspension or emulsion. If one of the phase is solid and the other phase is liquid, in which solid is insoluble, the biphasic dosage form is called as suspensions. However, if both the phases are liquid, immiscible with each other, the biphasic dosage form is known as emulsions. Thus, a biphasic liquid dosage form is a two-phase system composed of an insoluble solid or an immiscible liquid in another liquid. In this lecture, we will be talking about pharmaceutical suspensions only. Pharmaceutical suspensions are heterogeneous dispersion consisting of insoluble solid particles termed as internal phase. Usually, they are drug particles dispersed uniformly throughout the liquid termed as external phase. Pharmaceutical suspensions are preferred as dosage form if drug to be dispensed has solubility issues. Insoluble drugs can be formulated as tablets or capsule, but for patients such as pediatric or geriatrics who have difficulty in swallowing solid dosage form, liquid suspensions are preferred choice. Furthermore, compared to monophasic liquids, disagreeable taste of drug can be better masked by suspension formulation. In addition, drugs in suspension are chemically more stable than in solution. Suspension have unique properties due to the presence of an interface, that is, the boundary region between two phases. From formulation point of view, the most important property of interface is that it possesses a positive free energy. This positive free energy makes the suspensions thermodynamically unstable. And the foremost problem is settling of drug particles in suspensions that necessitates shaking the formulation by patients before use. Thus, the primary objective of the formulation scientist is to work upon the interfacial forces and free energy so as to develop a suspension which remains stable and elegant throughout its self-life. Suspensions can be classified on the basis of size of dispersed particles as molecular dispersion with a size less than 1 nanometer, colloidal dispersion in a size range of 0.1 to 0.2 micrometer, and coarse dispersion with a size greater than 1 micrometer. It can also be classified on the basis of behavior of dispersed phase as flocculated suspensions and deflocculated suspensions. Another mode of classification is on the basis of route of administration, that is, administered by oral route, parenteral route, topical route, ophthalmic route, and pulmonary route. A miscellaneous class can include magmas, aerosols, and foams. We discussed various types of suspension that are used in pharmaceuticals, but the discussion in this lecture is limited to suspension with particle having diameters greater than 1 micron and used as liquids for oral delivery. Suspensions form an important class of pharmaceutical dosage forms. These dispersed systems present many formulations, stability, manufacturing and packaging challenges. Almost all type of suspension systems separate on standing. The formulator's main concern, therefore, is not necessary to try to eliminate separation, but rather to decrease the rate of the settling and to permit easy resuspendability of any settled particulate matter. A satisfactory suspension must remain sufficiently homogeneous for at least the period of time necessary to remove and administer the required dose after shaking its container. Irrespective of type, an optimum pharmaceutical suspension is one in which drug is dispersed uniformly throughout external phase. Suspensions contains drug dispersed in an external phase. This means that drug must possess low aqueous solubility. Drugs with solubility less than 0.1 mg per ml are preferred to formulate as suspension. Crystalline form of drugs are preferred over amorphous form because of their low aqueous solubility. In addition, amorphous materials undergoes particle growth. Apart from solubility, stability of drugs should also be considered. Generally, large size drug particles require milling for better suspendability. The particle size of suspended insoluble drugs are important consideration in formulating stable pharmaceutical suspensions. The particle size and side distribution of the suspended drug influence the product appearance, solubility, resuspendability, bioavailability, and overall stability of pharmaceutical suspensions. Wide distributions in particle size often lead to high density suspensions, whereas systems with large size particle frequently produce suspension with high sedimentation rates. Particle size reduction in the range of 1 to 20 micrometer has a beneficial effect on the physical stability, and such fine particle suspension produce slow and uniform sedimentation rates. Large size particles have higher sedimentation rates as described by Stokes' law, that suggests V equals to 2R square multiplied by difference in density multiplied by gravitational constant divided by 9 eta, or alternatively it can be written as D square multiplied by difference in density multiplied by gravitational constant G divided by 18 eta. In this equation, V is velocity of sedimentation, R is radius, capital D is diameter of particle, small d1 and d2 is density of particle and liquid respectively, small g is gravitational constant, and eta is the viscosity of medium. Thus, large size particles results in non-uniformity and dose variations. To develop uniformly dispersed suspensions, particle diameter is to be controlled usually by process of milling using mills. Some of the mills used for particle size reductions are shown in this particular slide. It consists of ball mill, hammer mill, spiral jet mill, colloid mill, and fluid energy mill. Now, because of milling, energy is introduced into the system, that is represented by equation delta G equals to lambda multiplied by delta A. In this equation, delta G represents change in free energy due to milling. Lambda represents interfacial tension, and delta A represents change in area due to milling. Thus, increase in free energy, that is delta G, makes the suspension thermodynamically unstable. Therefore, it is the responsibility of formulation scientist to decrease free energy to generate a stable suspension.
We have discussed the concept of free energy.
there are two approaches for reduction of free energy. First one is reduction of surface area that occurs automatically due to aggregation or settling that further results in increase in particle size, but undesirability is associated with this kind of reduction in free energy because sedimentation occurs and it results in loss of uniformity. The second choice is addition of surfactant. Surfactant is added to reduce the surface tension or interfacial tension between solid particles and liquids. Addition of surfactant decreases surface tension and causes wetting of insoluble solids. It involves three steps. First one is adhesional wetting, in which contact angle is 180 degree. In this particular step, the surface of solid is brought into contact with the liquid surface. Second step is immersional wetting, in which contact angle is around 90 degree. The particles in this step is then forced below the surface of the liquid. And the last step is spreading wetting. The contact angle now becomes zero. And in this step, the liquid spreads over the entire surface of the solid. This property is very important because suspension involves use of insoluble drugs having poor affinity for water and are extremely difficult to disperse and require a wetting agent. We'll now discuss the concept of electric double layer that exists on the surface of suspended particles. Formulation of a suspension necessitates the use of ionic surface active agents as suspending agents. The surface active agents are oriented at the interface so that the charged groups form the outside surface. The presence of charge at an interface has profound effect on the nature of interfacial region. Figure in this slide presents a model of interfacial region of a charged surface and provides a good basis for understanding the behavior of pharmaceutical suspension. A layer of opposite charge ions is sufficiently held together by the charged surface so that the ions move with the surface. This particular layer is known as stern layer. The surface charge is not completely balanced by the stern layer. And a second region, that is diffuse layer, is necessary for complete balance of the surface charge. The diffuse layer contains both anions and cations, but ions that are of opposite charge to the surface predominate so that in the neighboring area of any charged particle, there exists an ion atmosphere having a net charge that is opposite to that of the surface. The concept of a diffuse double layer was developed by Guy and Chapman to describe the transition from points near the charged surface to the electrically neutral bulk solution. This mobile layer of ions has a definite thickness, which is approximated by the so-called Debye length, that is depicted by 1 by k. The equation for Debye length is 1 by k equals to dkt divided by 2ne square z square whole bracket is to power 1 by 2, or it has been kept in a square root, where d is dielectric constant of medium and the concentration of ion in the bulk solution phase, e is electronic charge, z is valence, t is temperature, and k is Boltzmann constant. in context to discussion on electric double layer that exist on the solid particle, lyophobic materials in suspension are sensitive to the addition of salts, whereas lyophilic materials are not. Addition of large amounts of electrolyte to a solution of a lyophilic material results in precipitation of lyophilic material, although dilution with the vehicle reverses the precipitation. As distinct from lyophilic material, dilution with the vehicle does not reverse the precipitation of lyophobic solids. However, in the case of lyophobic material, one may not observe aggregation, the desired form of matrix formation during sedimentation. The stability of lyophobic colloids is also reduced by lowering the repulsive potential of the electrochemical double layer or by decreasing the degree of hydration. Note that increasing the concentration of ions in the solution decreases the thickness of the diffused double layer by swamping, and therefore aggregation is encouraged. Specific adsorption of an ion by the system also neutralizes the surface charge of the particle and allows aggregation. The concentration of electrolyte needed to effect optimal aggregation depends on the balance and type of interacting ion. Addition of electrolyte past this point may result in a reversal of charge, which in turn would cause deaggregation and ultimate caking of the system. These ion effects can be systemized by referring to the Schulze-Hardy rule. The Schulze-Hardy rule states that the valence of the ions having a charge opposite to that of the hydrophobic particle appears to determine the effectiveness of the electrolyte in aggregating the particles. The aggregating value or efficiency therefore increases with the valence of the ions. Divalent ions are 10 times as effective as monovalent. Trivalent are 1000 times as effective as monovalent. It is important to remember that this rule is valid only for systems in which there is no chemical interaction between the aggregating electrolyte and the ions of the double layer of the particle surface. The influence of valence and concentration on the aggregation of a lyophobic particle suspension can be determined experimentally by either measuring the change in zeta potential or by observing the degree of aggregation in terms of some measurable parameters such as sediment height. Although it is not pharmaceutically useful to a great extent, the Hofmeister or lyotropic series rule applies to hydrophilic particles in a manner somewhat analogous to Schulze-Hardy rule and takes into account not only the charge but also the ionic size and hydration capability. Protective property of hydrophilic colloid, that is protective colloid, to stabilize hydrophobic particles by adsorption is designated by a number that is known as Gould number. Many observed properties of dispersed system reflect the net force of interaction between the particles or globules that the system may comprise of. Various forces has been identified in this context that includes electrostatic repulsive forces that arises from overlapping of diffuse double layer of approaching surface. These forces depend greatly on concentration and balance of electrolyte in solution. The second force is van der Waals attractive forces that arise from electromagnetic fluctuations in the molecules that make up the surface. These forces are largely independent of the electrolyte. Another forces are repulsive hydration forces that arise from the structuring of water in interfacial region. Bond repulsive forces are of short range and operate over distances of atomic dimensions. They are due to the repulsive effect of atomic orbital overlap. Next category is adhesive forces that arises when surfaces are in contact. And last is steric repulsive forces that depends on the size, geometry, and conformations of molecules that are adsorbed on the surface. The balance between electrostatic repulsive and van der Waals attractive forces as a function of electrolyte concentrations is known as DLVO theory. Derjagin, Landieu, Verwey, and Overbeek recognize the concept of balance between electrostatic repulsive and van der Waals attractive forces between particles. Thus, the concept has become known as DLVO theory. Figure in this slide illustrates the repulsive double layer and attractive van der Waal forces at 3 electrolyte concentrations. At low electrolyte concentration, the repulsive forces predominate so that the particles remain independent and the system is considered dispersed. At high electrolyte concentration, the repulsive forces are greatly reduced so that the attractive van der Waals forces predominate. The net attractive forces that the particles encounter cause the formation of an aggregate of particles, a process known as coagulation. Thus, the DLVO theory explains the fact that the addition of electrolyte to a colloidal system causes coagulation. When repulsive hydration and bond repulsive forces are considered along with the double layer repulsive and van der Waals attractive forces, the net force diagram can be shown as depicted in the slide. See, as two particles approach each other in an aqueous medium of proper electrolyte concentration, a weak attractive forces exist just beyond the range of double layer repulsive forces. This attractive region is called the secondary minimum and is responsible for the particle interaction termed flocculation. Particles therefore experience attraction at significant interparticle distances, that is 220 nanometers, and form the fibrous, fluffy, open network of aggregated particles known as flocules. Such a suspension is called flocculated suspension. A repulsive barrier termed primary maximum separates the secondary minimum from the primary minimum. The magnitude of the repulsive force at the primary maximum determines whether a flocculated system will remain flocculated. If the thermal energy in the system is similar to or greater than the repulsive barrier, then the particles in the system are able to move close together, that is 0.5 to 2 nanometer, and encounter strong attraction due to primary minimum. The strong attraction in the primary minimum gives rise to particle interaction termed coagulation. At low electrolyte concentration, the interaction curve contains a much larger primary maximum than at higher ionic strength conditions, and particle interactions are minimized. Such a suspension is called dispersed, deflocculated, or peptized one. In this suspension type, the individual particles are dispersed as discrete entities, This suspension type sediments slowly, attains the lowest possible sediment height, and owing to the closeness of the particle surface upon sedimentation, possesses a high potential for caking because of the ease of formation of extensive crystal bridging. Let us now discuss formulation components. An acceptable suspension possesses certain desirable qualities. The suspended material should not settle rapidly. The particles that do settle to the bottom of the container must not form a hard cake, but should be rapidly redispersed into a uniform mixture when the container is shaken. The suggestion must not be too viscous to pour freely from the orifice of the bottle or to flow through the syringe needle. Suspension must have an acceptable color and odor too. In order to meet all necessary requirements, an artistic selection of formulation additives is warranted. Current discussion pertains to various aspects related to product development of suspension, including selection of formulation additives, processing, packaging, and stabilizing finished product. Wetting agents. Wetting of powder involves the use of surfactants to decrease the solid-liquid interfacial tension and the contact angle between solid particle and the liquid vehicle. Common surfactants used as wetting agents include non-ionic type, that is polyoxyalkyl ethers, polyoxyalkyl phenyl ethers, polyoxyhydrogenated castor oil, sorbitone esters, and polyoxysorbitone esters. Anionic type, docusate sodium and sodium lauryl sulfate. The best range for wetting and spreading by non-ionic surfactants is between a hydrophile-lipophile balance, that is HLV value of 7 to 10. Deflocculants and dispersing agents are another category of formulation components under discussion. These do not appreciably lower surface and interfacial tension. They have little tendency to create foam or wet particles. They are generally not considered safe for internal use. For oral products specifically, lecithin or lecithin derivatives are only acceptable dispersant. Lecithins vary in water solubility and dispersibility characteristics. Other examples do include sodium and potassium carbonates, tannin compounds, sodium silicates, polyacrylates, and gum arabic. A category of flocculating agent is also a very important formulation component. These are generally neutral electrolytes capable of reducing the zeta potential of suspended charged particles to zero. For weakly charged water-soluble organic non-electrolytes, monovalent ion, that is sodium chloride and potassium chloride, can be used. For insoluble, highly charged and polyelectrolyte species, water-soluble divalent or trivalent ions such as calcium salts, aluminium chloride, sulfates and citrates, and potassium biphosphate can be used in a concentration range of 0.01 to 1%. This concentration range is applicable to monovalent ions as well as multivalent ions. Suspending agents retard the settling and agglomeration of the particles by functioning as an energy barrier. It minimizes interparticle attraction and ultimate aggregation. This category generally include protective colloids, viscosity-inducing agents, and surfactants. some of the suspending agents used to a large extent in formulation include modified cellulose polymers, proteins such as gelatin, and totally synthetic polymers too. First of all, we'll discuss protective colloids. Suspensions may not appear elegant due to the clusters of particles. Therefore, protective colloids provide elegance and free flow when incorporated into suspension by either increasing the zeta potential or by formation of a mechanical barrier around particles. Protective colloids do not reduce interfacial tension, and these are used in higher concentrations than surfactants. Certain common examples include gelatin, albumin, acacia, tragacanth, and sodium oleate. Viscosity welders are used to increase the viscosity of the liquid preparation. An increase in viscosity may be desirable to improve the palatability or stability. Agents like polyvinyl pyrrolidone, cellulose derivatives like methyl cellulose, propyl cellulose can be used for this purpose. Viscosity inducing polymers are known to form molecular complexes with a variety of organic and inorganic drugs and hence should be used with caution. Highly viscid solution may resist dilution by gastrointestinal or intestinal fluid and may affect drug release and subsequent absorption. Various viscosity modifiers that are utilized during preparation of suspension includes acacia, alginic acid, bentonite, carbomer resins, carboxymethyl cellulose, colloidal silicon dioxide, iota carrageenan, microcrystalline cellulose with sodium carboxymethyl cellulose, methyl cellulose, povidone, propylene glycol, alginate, sodium CMC, sodium starch glycolate, tragacanth, and xanthan gum. Out of various categories of formulation components, two major categories under discussion are modified cellulose polymers and clays. Modified cellulose polymers includes sodium carboxymethyl cellulose, that is anionic in nature, methyl cellulose, that is non-ionic in nature, and hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, that is also known as methocell, it is also non-ionic in nature. Sodium carboxymethyl cellulose, or more commonly called as sodium CMC, is incompatible with a number of electrolytes and quaternary ammonium compounds, and it forms complexes with certain surfactants too. Methyl cellulose and hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose gels on heating and get affected by addition of electrolytes. Clays are essentially hydrated aluminium or magnesium silicates. They hydrate in water to form colloidal dispersions with high viscosities. The pH of aqueous clay dispersions lies in the range of pH 8.5 to 9.5. Therefore, they also possess some acid neutralizing capacity. In general, 5 to 10% concentrations of the clay form firm opaque gels. Clays are most stable in a system with a pH value between 9 to 11. Dispersions of the clays are drastically affected by presence of electrolytes. Ethanol adversely affects viscosity characteristics by dehydrating the colloid. Clay suspensions and gels are excellent media for mold and bacterial growth. Therefore, it should be adequately preserved with non-ionic antimicrobial preservatives. The paraben esters and benzoates are useful, but cationic quaternary preservatives are ineffective in this case. Heat and aging usually increases the viscosity of clay mixtures. Apart from wetting, dispersing, suspending, viscosity-inducing agents, certain other formulation adjuvants are required for developing a pharmaceutically elegant suspension. These agents include the preservative, color, perfume, and flavor. They may materially affect the characteristic of the suspension system. In general, most colors are used in small quantities and are usually compatible. Flavors and perfumes are similarly used and are also usually compatible with the vehicle. To illustrate that one must be on guard against adjuvant interaction, it is noted that Wien and Dempsey suggested that the adsorptive power of kaolin suspensions can reduce the activity of some preservatives. Kaolin hurt the quaternary vinylzirconium chloride, but not the non-ionic and less surface active M-cresol. Similarly, it was shown that procaine penicillin adsorbed the quaternary benzalkonium chloride. These formulation adjuvants were discussed in detail in other modules, hence I will not talk much over these excipients here. So, students, let us now summarize what we have learnt from this particular module today. From the whole discussion, we can conclude that biphasic systems are essentially unstable system, and it is the responsibility of formulator to generate a stable system apart from considering its safety and efficacy. The kinetics involved in interaction between dispersed phase and bulk phase should be clearly understood in order to make a proper selection of excipients for product development. Particle characteristics and their behavior, specifically in case of suspension, depicts major concern, and a thorough understanding we gained from this discussion will really help us to develop suspension with desired characteristics. As we all know, the suspending agents play a major role in product development. A wise selection will definitely help formulation scientists. Students are suggested to refer standard literature and e-text attached to this module for subsequent reading. Thank you.